Hello, everybody. Welcome into Talking Fitchburg on this Friday, March 5th, 2021. Thanks for ending your Friday night right here on Talking Fitchburg. Glad you're joining us. We've got a busy show coming up for you today. I don't got a lot to say because we have some great guests. We've got Adam Dornan from the Fitchburg Fire Department. Give us an update on why it's so important to start thinking about changing those batteries and those smoke detectors, checking those detectors, and maybe even replacing them. We'll break that all down coming up here in our digest segment. Plus, we're checking with the Fitchburg Public Library. We got Wendy and Phil on the show today, and they'll be talking about a lot of great stuff happening at the library. Even though it's closed up right now, they still got a lot of fun stuff going on. We'll break that down for you coming up here in just a little bit of time. And speaking of the library, we've got a list of what's coming up next week for activities here. So start your week off right with the youth services programs. And here are some of those programs. Storytime kicks off on Monday in their virtual Storytime room. Tuesday, got Storytime the STEM. Callers, head over to Fitchburg Public Library's Facebook page to access the videos in specific on the STEM storytime theme. Take Home Tuesday continues. Wednesday, you got homemade cards, making cards for the month. Sounds like a lot of fun. Indoor hopscotch on Thursday. Look out. Andrew, when's the last time you've done hopscotch? Long time, he says. Browse the world's language section of the children's library on Friday, and some ongoing programs. The grab bags are still up for the teens, and they still got the 1,000 books before kindergarten program going on as well. All right, improve how your mask fits and protects you. Yeah, I want to make sure we've got more data on using double masks and everything else. But here's what it says: pick a mask with layers to stop more respiratory droplets from getting into and out of your mask. The goal is to have it fit snugly against your face. Do not combine two disposable masks or combine a KN95 mask with other masks. You can learn more about masks and the whole checklist there on the CDC's website if you are interested in finding out what is that best fit for masks. All right, finally, consumer protection injuries during a COVID-19 pandemic. We've got a list of breakdowns of how that looks. And we start here with saying that the pandemic has impacted the way U.S. consumers live, work, and go to school. And a report from the U.S. Consumer Product Safety Commission released the National Consumer Protection Week now shows an impact on hospital emergency room ER-treated injuries from consumer products as well. The effect of the novel coronavirus pandemic on the preliminary estimates suggest that although consumers may have avoided the ER for some product-related injuries, they did go at nearly the same rate as previous years with more severe injuries. Yeah, not so good. And we've heard these throughout, and especially Andrew's on that one right now with the cleaning agent. That's at 84% for age. And it was because of the lack of supplies, right? Supply and demand definitely made it a little bit more difficult to get the right information. So some people pick some things that don't go together, and that ended up being causing some ER visits. We'll have this full report online for you. You can check out when Andrew posts up the headlines for the day. All right, that does it for me. Coming up next, we open up our guest segment. We'll be talking with Adam Dorn, Fitchburg Fire Department, about changing those smoke detectors. Next, right here on Talking Fitchburg.
Find good stuff at Goodwill and bring good home.
I may never have met you. We don't go way back. Maybe we wouldn't even be friends if we did. But when you wear a mask, you have my respect. Because your mask doesn't protect you. It protects me. I wear my mask to protect you. Mask up, America.
Look at that, it's so sad. Welcome back into Talking Fitchburg. Joining me today for the Fitchburg Fire Department, it's our public education dude, Adam Dorn. Dude, what's up?
Not much. How are you?
I am full of it today, so this should be an interesting segment at best. You bring the best out of me, Dorn. That's all I'm saying. Hey, first and foremost, I just want to say thank you. You have been just on a roll this year with bringing in some awesome guests, so I really appreciate it. If you haven't had a chance to go check out the library this year of all the great videos and interviews that we've done, we've had just a, like, great, great lineup this year, and it's because of that guy right there. It's Dorn.
Well,
and today, yeah, we appreciate it, Dorn. Let's we're getting close here to our time change, and that does bring up a great time to really think about changing your smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors, and why do we associate it with the time change?
So I don't even know how long ago it was, but a few years ago. The time change actually took place roughly 6 months apart. So it was a great thing for the fire service to latch on to say, hey, when you change your clocks, let's change the batteries in the smoke detectors as well, because a lot of times people would change the batteries in their clocks at the same time to make sure that they wouldn't stop on them unexpectedly. So it was just an easy way for people to remember to make sure they always had working smoke detectors. Now with some of the changes that have happened with daylight savings times, where they kind of push it back and move it around a little bit, it's not quite 6 months, but it's still a great way to remember to change the batteries in your smoke detectors.
Why, in this day and age, why are we still dealing with the batteries? Why are we still, you know, shouldn't there be an easier technology out there? Why isn't this Wi-Fi'd yet?
Yeah, so your smoke detectors still need some sort of a power to make them operate. And whether that's hardwired in most of the newer smoke detectors in your homes, and the newer homes, they're all interconnected. So that allows them to kind of work off of one power source. But if that power source is interrupted, say the power goes out, you still need the batteries in there or some sort of a power supply in the smoke detectors to make sure that they will work when the power does go out. So that's why we still need these batteries. That's why it's not all Wi-Fi. That's just one of the newer technologies that's available, but it does not solve all of our problems that we may face.
And what about the ones that do have that direct power? You know, they all come with a battery backup mostly because of that very reason.
Exactly. And that's exactly what it is, that if the power does go out, they still want to make sure that there's power in that smoke detector so it operates, because sometimes the power may go out because of a fire, but there may not be enough smoke to set off the smoke detector before the power goes off.
I like the interconnectivity idea, because if one goes off, they all go off. And it wasn't a technology that was affordable in homes, but definitely it's getting there. It's still pretty pricey. I've been actually pricing them out because I'm anticipating here. I've been trying to. I think I've still got a couple alarms that are probably original house date, but I've got different alarms around those. So I'm working through it. But why would it be important to even consider, you know, and I know we all know on the surface why it's important that maybe to put in one of those systems. But, you know, how long does it take smoke to maybe travel, let's say fire starts in the basement, to maybe a second floor or third floor, whatever the case may be?
Great question, right? So if we are living in a perfect world, and when we go to bed, let's just say most fires happen at night when we're sleeping, right? And if we're in bed sleeping, we have our bedroom door closed. If we have a door at the top or the bottom of the stairs, that door is closed. Now we have a whole nother level that the smoke needs to go through. Say it's the main level. So you're sleeping on a second floor, you have the main level of your home, and then you probably have a door to the stairway that goes to the basement. So that door is closed. And if the fire starts in the back corner of your basement away from the stairs, it has to travel all of that distance to make the smoke detector go off upstairs. It has to go through at least two doors, your bedroom door and the door at the top of the steps, plus all the other space. So when they're interconnected, you get notification right away that, hey, there's a smoke detector that has been activated somewhere in your house. You may not know where it is, but you will at least know something is going on. And by having them interconnected, it gives you more time, more opportunity to get out of a house. In the past, they used to say you'd have 20 minutes to get out of a house in what we call legacy construction, where 2x4s were actually 2 inches by 4 inches, and there was nothing else. You know, they weren't glued together, and they weren't pressed together with gusset plates and all that other stuff. Nowadays, in our construction today, we have about 3 minutes to get out of the house once the fire starts.
That's just amazing. Yeah. Absolutely. And I appreciate you explaining it, because I think it is a real problem in a lot of homes that, you know, even if they're not interconnected, if you have one in the basement, and I'm just thinking, I have a tri-level, that could be, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4 doors closed that I might never hear any of the alarms as it would make it up to my house or up to where we sleep. And everybody's kind of in the same area, so it would be kind of a tough thing. Let's turn our attention to the 10-year replacement plan, something that's come up in the last several years. And if you've sat through one of our interviews, we've talked about this in the past, but why this 10-year mark now of these things need to just be totally replaced and put in a new smoke detector?
Yeah. After about 10 years, the smoke detectors kind of reach the end of their life cycle. They are always working. That's one of the reasons why they have that power supply. They're always working. They're always making sure that there's no smoke in the air. And if there is, it will alarm. One of the other things to think about is that if you put a smoke detector up, right, and you never do any kind of maintenance to it, which we're supposed to, which I'm sure, you know, to be honest, probably the majority of the people don't do the maintenance that they're supposed to keep their smoke detectors operating properly. So we need to make sure that they're being cleaned. That could be in multiple different ways of doing it, but whatever the manufacturer recommendation is, that's what we're supposed to do. But if we don't clean them and we don't maintain them and test them that they are operating, we need to make sure that they're replaced after 10 years, because it just, they get to the end of the life cycle and they need to be, you know, you have to put a new one up. It's reached the end of the life cycle. It's served its purpose for the time.
Yeah, I think I was thinking technology too is probably changes, you know, as frequently as it does now. Certainly I'm thinking in the next 5 years, you know, most of them will probably be a Wi-Fi or some connected way. Certainly you always have the opportunity to buy smoke detectors of the original state, but not all smoke detectors are made alike. You can get your basic smoke detector, but there are other combination smoke detectors out there. And it used to think, well, carbon monoxide smoke detector, but that's even increased more to like explosive or material, I don't know, gases, I guess you would say, that can cause that. So first, what's out there in the market that you see in Doran? What do we have for options for besides just smoke detector?
Yeah, so there is the photoelectric smoke detector. There's the ionization smoke detector. Those are the two main smoke detectors. They basically work the same. One works better with a smoldering fire. One works better with a free burning fire. The difference between the two of them is pretty small, that it really doesn't make a difference which one you use. They will both work appropriately. But with that, the smoke detectors are being coupled with the carbon monoxide detectors. So you have a combination carbon monoxide smoke detector. There's also standalone carbon monoxide detectors, and there are carbon monoxide and explosive gas detectors. So those are the three real big ones that we've seen out there. I'm sure there's some other ones, but those are the three most prevalent ones that are available to the public.
All right, Dord, final message. Make me want to put up a smoke alarm in every single bedroom of my house. Go.
All right. So think about this. If you have the fire that happens in your basement, like we talked about before, you're on the second level of your home. In order for the smoke detector to go off in your bedroom, it has to go through at least 2 doors, maybe 4 doors by the time it gets there. But if you make sure that you sleep with your bedroom door closed, make sure you put a smoke detector on the inside of your bedroom and out in the hallway outside of your sleeping area, outside of the bedrooms. You want one on every level of your home, including your basement, at a minimum. That way, doesn't matter where the fire starts, you will get some sort of a notification, whether they are interconnected or not. They all need to be there. They all need to be working. Make sure you test your smoke alarms at least once a month to make sure they're working properly, because if you don't, they may not. You may not get out of a house fire or a fire that out of your house where there's a fire inside. And the biggest thing, make sure they just plain old work. Make sure the batteries are in there. Don't take the batteries out because, you know, maybe mom or dad burnt something on the stove again, or maybe the kids burned something on the stove and they were trying to cook and they're learning to cook. Don't take the smoke alarms, the batteries out of the smoke alarms. Make sure they're in there. There's newer technology out there where you can leave it, batteries in there. You can hush the smoke detector, leave it in place. It will still operate as needed. And most importantly, this weekend, when you test your smoke alarms and you check your clocks to change the time on them, test your smoke alarms as well, because that alone could save your life. It could get you out of your house so that you can stay, see the rest of your family and make sure that they know you're doing what you need to do to stay safe.
Yeah, and especially if you have kids, you're setting the example for the kids in the future. So doing that just gives them an idea. Well, I guess my parents always did it, so I suppose I better do it too. Dorn, thank you so much for all the information. Certainly, you've got some information up on your website, the fire department's website, fitchburgwi.gov. And Adam, we'll look forward to having you back on real soon. Thank you, buddy.
Thanks, Jeremy. Have a good day.
You too, Adam Dorn, Fitchburg Fire Department, our public educator, and so much more for everything he does for us here at Fact TV. All right, take a quick break. More to come. You're watching Talking Fitchburg.
You could be spreading the coronavirus without realizing you have it. So follow guidance from authorities where you live and do your part. It's important to limit in-person interaction with anyone outside of your immediate household. But phone and video chat are safe ways to connect. It's also important to limit any social gathering. This advice applies to people of any age, including teens and younger adults. Visit coronavirus.gov for the latest information.
Our hearts are made stronger by how we treat others.
Put her there.
The light you share can impact those around you, but so can the darkness.
Later, twerps!
Did Pete saying mean things bother
you? So when you reach out to another person, take a moment to consider how they will feel and let your heart be the key to making a difference. Because of you, someone's entire day, year, or even life can change.
In every heart, there's hope.
Welcome back into Talking Fitchburg. Joining me today from the Fitchburg Public Library is that Phil? You thought I'd say Wendy. Nah, it's Phil and Wendy. Welcome back to the show. How are you both doing?
Good.
We're hanging in there. How are you guys doing? Mm-hmm.
We are doing as good as we can be doing right now. You know, things are slowly coming back online, you know, around the world. And, you know, fingers crossed that when it really comes down to it, it's all the folks like you at the library, you know, like you're just excited to be back, you know, get back and see you guys
someday
and take advantage of programs, right?
Yeah.
So hey, you still got a lot of stuff going on at the library, and we're very excited to continue to share that. So all right, who's up first? Is it the chief or sure. Is it Phil?
I'll go first.
It's the chief. Right, Wendy, tell us what do you got going on.
So we may not be able to let people come in and browse our magazines here at the library, but we have a very new exciting addition to our Overdrive online book and audiobooks has been what we've been doing through Overdrive, but now they've added magazines. And I was a little bit dubious because I felt like you'd really need a tablet for it to be a good reading experience. But it's fantastic and I love it. You can do it on a mobile device for sure. But I've been doing it just on a laptop. The great thing is that they are simultaneous use. So you don't have to be on a hold list for anything. You can just go in, check it out immediately, read it right away. It's basically like your print magazine, but you're, you know, scrolling through it on your computer. Not every magazine is on there, but some of the really good ones that I've been reading, I like cooking magazines. So they have Cooks Illustrated, they have Food Network. Some of the news ones are really good. They have Newsweek, they have The Week, The Economist. So not everything, but a lot of really good stuff. And it's just super easy to check it out right away and read it. You know, I think that's some of the frustration that we all have with ebooks on OverDrive is that you have to be on hold for a lot of them. So the experience of just
that's amazing.
Immediately is fantastic. So I would recommend
how many magazines do you estimate that are on there?
Like, do they give you guys a number?
3,000 titles. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Wow. All right, check this out.
Yeah. And it doesn't count against your checkout total. So you can still be checking out as many books and audiobooks as you'd like. It doesn't count against that. So yeah, it's really just excellent added feature.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to go ahead and leave and go check out some fishing.
I'll be back.
Yeah. You guys just finish this interview by yourself and we'll take care of that. No, that's pretty cool. Yeah, take advantage of it, and hopefully that will stay for time to come. But that's awesome. Well, leaving that aside, I mean, now you set the bar so high. What else could there be?
Well, the youth services department is continuing to run a special program for teens called the Teen Takeaway Program. If you basically through the curbside service, you can pick up a takeaway bag. Every month they have a specific genre that they highlight. The bag itself contains a library book that will already be checked out to you, a book that you get to keep, some activities, and some fun surprises that kind of come with it. This month's genre is mystery. And if people are interested, they should just give us an email or check out our website. There's information on how to get in touch with the youth department about getting that set up. So they've been popular.
Yeah, I'm really excited about this one. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was going to say, I bet you it's got to be pretty pretty popular. It's just it takes like the best of everything that you guys have to offer right now and be able to put it into that takeaway bag is awesome. So glad to hear it's popular.
Definitely.
Tell us about the newsletter too. You've got that some of the activities back up online now.
Yeah, absolutely. We have the newsletter, we've got it back on the website. So we have it set out for it has the whole month's kind of schedule laid out. So for our online programs, for our Take Home Tuesdays, for the Tease Takeaway programs, for some of the adult craft things that they've been doing, the book clubs that we're running on Zoom, it has all of that information on there. It's just on the main page of our website. Similar to the way we used to run it, but we've got it back up and running. So if you're kind of curious about the stuff we're doing and when those programs are being run, take a look. So,
well, I'll tell you, that helps me when I'm trying to put our newscast together every day. I've enjoyed having that piece back. Not that checking out your Facebook page hasn't been fun to watch your guys' videos. Right. They're hilarious, but yeah, that's good. Good to see that coming back. Wendy, overall, how have things been going? We're kind of coming up on a year now. You've seen so many different changes over this past year. I guess, what is your synopsis that you would say, where is the library today?
I think things are going very smoothly right now. So I would say early in the pandemic, we had to make changes all the time. So as new information came out about quarantine materials or about mask wearing and staying 6 feet apart, you know, we had to spend a lot of time moving workstations around. So we do have all the staff in the building working, but they can do that safely. I think right now we're kind of in a happy continuum where things haven't been changing as drastically. Curbside is doing great. I think Phil has big news about curbside.
Yeah, we next week we are on track to hit 20,000 curbside orders fulfilled. So
20,000 curbside orders. That is. So. Does that mean that Phil has gone outside 20,000 times?
It like, feels like it.
Set a book out? That's
all the staff
that is an incredible number.
So. We have all the departments pitching in for curbside, which has been really, I think, a really good experience for everybody. So I'm happy with how things are going. It seems like patrons are really using the service. I am very much looking forward to the time that we can open the doors and be a normal library again. But, you know, we're pretty cautious about doing that until things are safe. So I'm just happy that things are going as well as they are.
Yeah, and from your takeaway too, I know you're keep up on what's happening with libraries across the country. Do you kind of mesh with what other libraries are doing, even in southern Wisconsin?
I think right now we're all kind of on the same page. I do think that people are looking at, you know, how to reopen and who's more comfortable opening sooner and later. So we'll kind of have to wait and see. I would say we're probably on the cautious end of it. I really feel responsible to keep the staff and the patrons safe. And I don't want to become a place where people because they want to come here, which is fantastic, but then that we end up seeing rates go up because of congregating. So we are looking real carefully at what other people are doing and kind of responding as we can. Yeah,
no, I think it's good to know, know about how you guys are compared to other libraries and kind of how it's going. I know it's been a lot of work behind the scenes to keep things going, but the creativity nonetheless has been amazing for the stuff that you have come up with. So it's really good. Any other things we need to know before we depart here?
One more thing I want to share is that we are getting ready to install a story walk in McKee Farms Park. So we're hoping this is going to be going up in the next couple of months. We want it to be ready for summer reading kickoff, which is going to be like mid-June. So a story walk is essentially a picture book that we chop up into 2-page spreads and we put them on like a kiosk so you can walk the walking loop around the park at McKee and follow along and read a picture book. And then a picture book will be changed a couple of times a year. But it's a really fun outdoor activity to get kids reading and active at the same time. And it's a nice way for people to kind of participate in literacy and library activities, but not in the library.
Well, I'm just thinking exercise and reading. I mean, those can be two difficult things, and combining that together in at McKee Farms Park, especially, there's so many fun things there already.
Experience to get a lot of exposure and see how people like it. You know, maybe we'll expand it to other parks in the future if it goes well. This is kind of a test for us. Kevin built us a little kiosk that's going to attach to a light post. So we're working out the kinks, but it should be really cool. I'm excited for it.
How are you going to pick which book to put in there? I mean, my goodness, there are so many great books out there. How are we going to decide?
I don't get to choose, which is kind of disappointing. Our youth services librarian will be the person that chooses.
Gotcha. All right. Well, thank you both so much for your time. A lot of great activities still happening out there. And your library is still wanting you to stay up to date with what's going on and continue to check out materials and much more. If people do want to learn more about the stuff we talked about today or just overall information, where can we find you at?
FitchburgWY.gov at library.
All right. Nice seeing you both. Stay safe out there and looking forward to having you both back up back with me on the show. Tongue tied here. You guys make me nervous.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye. Thanks. Yep,
thank you guys. Appreciate it. Wendy and Phil there again. Check out the website. A lot happening all the time at the library, and I can't wait to come in and give some air high fives once things do open back up. All right. We'll take a quick break. More to come. You're watching Talking Fitchburg.
We're all just trying to keep things running for those who rely on us. Ready? That's why we don't have time to be sick with the flu. And especially this year, no one has time to get sick. Get a flu shot for yourself and those around you too.
It takes all of us to slow the spread of the coronavirus. So follow guidance from authorities where you live and stay home unless absolutely necessary. Use a delivery service for essential items like food and medicine. If you must make essential trips, stay 6 feet apart from other people, wear a cloth face covering, and wash your hands for at least 20 seconds as often as possible. Visit coronavirus.gov for the latest information.
Welcome back to Talking Fitchburg. Wrapping up the show for my son has just not calmed down this whole show. He's just having a good Friday over there. So take a page out of his book and do whatever he's doing because he's having fun. All right. Thank you to the library and to the fire department for all their help. And just going to go into the weekend like that. Have a great weekend, everybody. We'll see you back here Monday.